everybody. How are you guys doing today? Before we start the message, I will invite you to pray for Glenda. Glenda Hart. Maybe you know her. You remember Ron Hart? Our brother was a lovely brother, serving always here at the church. And friend, he passed away when the Lord yesterday. And we know that he rests in peace now. But we need to pray for Glenda. And if you can text her, call her, or visit her, she will really appreciate that. Please, let us take a moment to pray for her. Heavenly Father, we are gathering right here because you allow us to be here. We want to worship you. We want to praise your name. But before we do that, we continue doing that, we ask you to bless Glenda and comfort her with your Holy Spirit. Give her strength and also to Ron's children and grandsons. We know it is hard. But we also have that hope and that faith that he will be with you in the same way that we are going to be with you forever. Because you promised us the eternal life. And you promised that those who believe in you will never die. And if we die right here, we will live eternally with you. So we give you thanks for Ron life and Glenda heart. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jacob and the worship team, Banda, because they guide us to worship God through the Holy Spirit. And that last song, inviting the Holy Spirit, and he's welcome here. So how many of you believe that God, the Holy Spirit of God, is here with us today?
Amen.
So if we believe that God is here, it's not me who is going to talk to you. But it's his word, it's God in Jesus Christ and through his Holy Spirit that I hope talk to our mind and touch our heart so we can be willing to obey what he says us today. So last week, Pastor Alan was talking about the work of the Holy Spirit. Today we're going to talk about the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And next week about the gift of the Holy Spirit. And you know, if you know Acts chapter 1, verse 8, when Jesus Christ told his disciples, and you will receive power from the Holy Spirit when he comes to you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and in all the world. A lot of Christians, brothers and sisters, they want that power from the Holy Spirit. They want that the Holy Spirit to work on them. By the way, you know, Pentecostal church, they came out from United Methodist Church 100 years ago, 110 years ago. But now they are like 540 million. Why? Because they do everything to the Holy Spirit. They believe that they receive the Holy Spirit. They believe they walk with the Spirit. They talk in tongues. They jump. They do everything in the Spirit. They reach people for Christ and for his kingdom with the Holy Spirit. When I was young, and you can say, that was a long time ago. My dad used to tell my brothers and I, and me, Jesus, tell me with who you are gathering, and I will let you know who are you going to be. And I said, really? Who are your friends? They said, well, I got it with my friends right there on the corner. They were like gangsters, gangs. But Dad, I'm not like them. You know, they are just my friend. I just go there and have fun with them. She said, Jesus, listen, if you got it with them, people will think that you are like them. Because you're walking with them. Because you're gathering with them. Because you're going out with them. And even if you don't do that bad thing that they do, people will think and believe that you do. Tell me with who you gather, and people will let you know who you are. Today we're going to have that reading from the scripture. And I don't know if we have it in the screens, but you can use your iPhone, your iPad, your cell phones, or your Bible if you have your Bible with you. And we're going to read from Galatians chapter 5. From 16 through 26. But I'm going to go back to 13, that first phrase. And if you are with me, please read it with me. It says, you, my brothers, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. And then Paul jumps to chapter 16. Well, we are going to jump to verse 16. And says, so I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. And in this part, I would like to ask the men, all the men, John and everybody, all the men, can you help me reading this part from verse 19 to 21? Law 19. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, and debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. And now I'm going to invite my sisters to help me reading verse 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. Let us pray. Lord, one more time, we ask you to talk to our mind and through your Holy Spirit to touch our heart. We want to walk with the Spirit. We do not want to follow the desires of our flesh. Talk to us and change us, transform us through your Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. If you are here for first time, second time, or a few weeks, and you haven't received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I invite you to open your heart. He wants to come and be with you and save you and take you with Him so you can be with Him forever, for all eternity. And why I am mentioning this? Because this letter, Paul wrote it to the Christians, to the church that was in Galatia. Galatians, Galatas, we say. So in that first half century, this church, they used to live like everybody else. But after Jesus Christ came to them and died for them, then Paul was teaching them how to live in a different way than how they used to live before. In verse 13, when he said, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use that freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another with love, in love." So what was going on 2,000 years ago? They said, well, Jesus Christ came from heaven and sacrificed himself for us. So he rescued us. So now we are free. We can do whatever we want because we are saved by grace, by faith in Jesus Christ. We have been justified by faith in Jesus. And now we are sanctified. So we can do whatever we want. And Paul said, no. Yes, you are free. But don't use that freedom to do whatever you want. And right there says that we are not under the law no more. So a lot of people do good things and they obey the law because they don't want to be punished. Paul said, no. You are free. You are set up free in Jesus Christ. You are not no more under the law. But that doesn't allow you to do whatever you want. I have three boys. One is 22 and the other one is 18. The one that is 22 is a nice boy. He's obedient, very smart, intelligent. He graduated from college already. The 18, he's also smart, but when he turned 18, he said, "Daddy, I got my AD now. I can do whatever I want." They said, no, that doesn't mean that because you turned 18 years old and you have your ID so you can be able to vote and to get your driving license and everything, because in Mexico, when you turn 18 years old, you are an adult. You can do wherever you want. But say, "Daddy, I'm so happy I have my ID. Now I can do whatever I want." No. Even if we're not there, because those two sons that we have, they're living in Mexico. We are not there to see them, to watch them, what they do, what they say. But they know that they belong to God. And they're not supposed to do the things or good things because the law said. Yes, the law is there and will be there always. But we don't do things like that because we don't want to be punished. We do things because we belong to God. We are God's people. And I asked him, "How do you think that people will know that you are a son of God? That you belong to God? That you are walking by the Spirit, with the Spirit?" Because if you don't tell, for example, at the high school, your classmate, your friends, that you are a Christian, how they will know that you are a son of God? That you walk with the Spirit, in the Spirit? So we went back here and we read this from verses 19 to 21. And it's obvious. The sinful nature, you cannot hide it. Everybody can see it. And when we go there here, it's not for you, for me, to look around your neighbor, your dad, your mom, and judge them. You're doing this, you're doing that. The Bible said that is the sinful nature. Don't do it. is for me. It's to think about my life. During that week, I was asking people, brothers, friends, people who come to church, people who don't come to church, how can you make a difference between a son of God and somebody who's not a son of God, a child of God? Somebody said, well, everybody is a son of God, is a child of God. He said, well, the Bible doesn't say that. You can see right here on those verses, if you're doing those things, Paul says, I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. So 2,000 years ago, they were thinking the same way that a lot of people think right now. That because we are saved by grace, and Jesus Christ died for us already on the cross, that we can do whatever we want. The Bible said no. So think about, if you have to choose between those 14, 17 sinful nature things that affect your life, which one can you choose? Somebody else says, well, I don't have none of those problems. They say, wow, so that means that you're perfect. You need to go with God now. But I think that if you're still here, and I'm here, it's because God is working with our life. He's preparing us for the eternal life. And we are still here, we need to change day by day. We are not perfect. And I said, you see, I'm a pastor, I'm a missionary, I'm your servant, I'm not perfect. So when I was reading this, I had to go back several times. And I even asked my wife. And she said, well, I don't have problems. I said, honey, come on, really? You're not perfect, I'm not perfect. Nobody's perfect. So we went back and we read this again. I said, well, you know what? Yes, I need to change in this area right here in my life. I know the brothers and sisters, they like to fight. That is in the list. Yes, it's right there. I know that sometimes husband and wife like to think bad about their relationship. They say, why? Sometimes we are like so angry and mad at people. Say, well, maybe I need to change that. Jude, John, people, they like to see others, you know, that, what is the iPhone right now? Number 12? No, 11? 12?
11.
And they want that one because their friend has that 12, number 12. So they want the iPhone number 12. Why? Because my friend has it and I don't have it. Does the Bible say something about that? Jealousy? Discord? Hatred? Ambitions? Factions? Envy? All? I used to drink a lot, but not anymore. You know, now I used to drink every day, but now I only get drunk every weekend. But that's fine. It's all Methodist does that. You know, that the United Methodist Church will be big. That's fine. Well, God is saying something right here. And Paul said, I warn you, as did I, like I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. That means, brothers and sisters, we, as them, 2,000 years ago, we have to think about ourselves and ask God to reveal us if there is something that we need to change in our life, that we need to cut, so we can be able to walk in the Spirit. This morning I was talking with, I did this, the magnet out of my, with my keys over there. I got a magnet that I showed the kids. You know the magnet? It has different poles. When you're trying to put them together, they don't get together because they're opposite poles. If you turn around, then they're going to get together. But sinful nature, the desires of the flesh, they're opposite with the Holy Spirit. They are in conflict with one another. They cannot go together. We cannot play around to be a Christian and still be doing those things that you know that God doesn't like. And that you know they are not correct. You don't have to confess to me or to nobody, but you have to confess to God and ask Him to help you to change and leave that end of your life out of your life completely. Verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Who's good here loving people? Everybody. We love our family, our couple, our children. Joy. I can see your smiling faces. We're happy every day because God is with us and we are with Him. We have peace because if you are with Christ, we have peace. He promised that. We're good people. We have faith. That is the reason that we are here. We are gentleness. But one more time. This list is not for me to judge others. I was thinking myself, and I was asking God to reveal me myself in which of those good fruit I need to work on. And I stopped right there on self-control. Because if we are God's people, the Holy Spirit is in us. Our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that. But if we don't have self-control, or we don't work with self-control, that fruit from the Holy Spirit, if we don't take care, will take us to the other 14, 17 sinful nature of the flesh. In a moment, right away, what happens when we have fruit in our house and one of those fruit gets bad? If you don't take it out, what will happen with the rest of the fruit? Huh? Yes. But it's only one and the rest is good or are good. Leave it there. We have to take it out right away. It's the same, brothers and sisters, in our life. I believe that we are God's people. I believe that we are the holy temple of the Holy Spirit. I believe that God is with us. But if there is one fruit, bad fruit in your life, in your mind, in your heart, that will affect the rest of your life. And you will not be able to walk correctly in the Spirit, with the Holy Spirit. So when I was thinking about my dad, and he said, Jesus, tell me who are your friends? Who are you company with? They said, nah, but I'm not like them. I'm not a gangster. I'm not a drug dealer. Jesus, but you are with them every day. As soon as you come back from school, from your job, you go there. And you are with them a lot of time. Be careful, don't go there. Don't gather with them. Don't walk with them. But guess what? I was young. I didn't pay attention. I didn't listen to my dad. I didn't obey my dad. And I become one of them. Because I was walking with them. And that affected my life and my relationship with God. That separated me from God. It was fun. It was funny, yes, but I wasn't paying attention to it. That bad fruit will affect the rest of my life. And I wasn't going to be able to walk with God and His Holy Spirit. Those who belong to Christ have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. And that was the only reason that I asked you, if you're here for first time or second time, or you haven't received Jesus Christ. Because those who are with Jesus Christ, that belongs to God, we have the Holy Spirit in our life. We are not allowed to walk or to do or to gather with those people who their nature is sinful. We cannot do the same things that we used to do before. We must crucify our sinful nature with God, with our passions and desires. And since we live by the Spirit, let us give instead with the Spirit. Brothers and sisters, you don't have to raise your hand, you don't have to stand down. But if you receive Jesus Christ already, you accepted Him as your Lord and Savior, we must stop doing that. Do you know what is it that affects your life in your relationship with God? I am not perfect. I still need to work and ask God to help me for my life. Specifically on self-control. Because when I don't have control of myself, I do things that I don't want to do. And that reminds me of Paul. You remember Paul? He said, the things that I want to do, I do it. I'm a bad person, Paul used to say. He said, please forgive me, God. I don't want to do that. Because we need to take care of self-control. So we don't go back to that sinful nature life. So if you haven't received Jesus Christ and you're still living in that sinful nature in your flesh, repent and ask God to come to your life through Jesus Christ and invite the Holy Spirit to be with you so you can walk with Him by faith in Jesus Christ. And if you are ready, a child of God, perfect, ask Him to reveal you what do you need to cut from the root in your life so you can be able to walk in the Spirit by faith in Jesus Christ. Close your eyes and think about being honest with God. Ask Him if you have problems with sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealous fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and all bad things that you know that affect your lives. And that, what God is putting in your mind right now, ask Him to forgive you for that. And ask Him to clean you from all unrighteousness. And ask Him to allow you to live in the Spirit, demonstrating, because that is the only way that people will know that we are His people, that we belong to Him, when we live by the Spirit, practicing the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Because you know what? Against such things, there is no law. Lord, we give you thanks because we know that you are faithful. That when you talk to us, we ask you to forgive us for any kind a sinful nature in our flesh. We know that you forgive us. And we know that you forgave us already through Jesus Christ in the cross. We ask you to clean us from all unrighteousness in our life. Help us during this time, 2019-2020, in this century, the life seems to look so hard to live. Because all what's going on around us, at school, at work, on technology, TV, cell phones, help us. Walk with you in the Spirit so we can be your witnesses everywhere, wherever we go, at any time. We ask you, Lord, this in the name of Jesus Christ, who sacrificed for us on the cross and who invited us to walk with him by faith and walk with him in the Spirit. Ask you this and we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, if somebody asks you with who you are gathering, with who you are walking, people will know who you are. If you walk in the Spirit, in Jesus Christ, people will see that in you. And they will know that we are God's. God bless. On that night in which he gave himself for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to God, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to God. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, given for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. And all together says, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord, we ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit to all of here who are gathering here in your presence, to this gift of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with one another, and one in ministry to the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. In Jesus Christ, amen. Lord, those who are assisting, can you please come forward? Remind you guys, brothers and sisters, and whoever is here for first time, second time, welcome. And the way that we serve communion is we take the bread and pour in the cup and take it at the same time. Everybody's welcome to have communion with us. Children are welcome. But remember, we as parents, we're responsible to teach them the meaning of that Holy Communion. And you don't have to be a member of this church to have communion. You're welcome. Of course, we want you to be a member of our church. So if you want to talk about that, let me know. And if there is somebody here who is not able to come and have communion, let us know so we can go and serve your communion at your seat. Please come and have communion. Jesus Christ invites you to have communion with him and with one another. This is not a United Methodist table. This is Jesus Christ's table, and it's him who invites us to have communion with him. Come and have communion.